Welcome to worship here at the Bloomer and New Auburn United Methodist Churches. How are you all doing on this rainy day?
All right.
Yeah, good. That's what I like to hear. So it's definitely different. I enjoy the rain, but I sure could do without some of this humidity. I tell you, it's been pretty rough the last couple of days. You walk outside, it's just kind of sticky. But it is a pleasure to be here with you, and I am really looking forward to our worship service this morning. If you are joining us via our website or Facebook or YouTube, we welcome you, and we're glad that you're able to spend some of your time with us today. We also encourage you, if you're not familiar with all of the resources we have available to you, that you would take some time and just connect with us on some of those, so you can check out some of the resources we have on our website at bloomerumc.com, and there you'll find sort of our mission and ministries, as well as some other information. We try to maintain active Facebook pages as well, so please get on there, like our pages, and interact with us that way. And then we also have a YouTube page at bloomerumc, and there we have a lot of our sermon content and other information on there. So please feel free to view that and go back if you are interested in some of the series that we have on there. I would like to take just a couple of moments to make a couple of announcements. And the first, if you're in the New Auburn Church, please remember we have some upcoming meetings this coming week. And so if you are on those committees, please remember and plan to be there for those. For those of you here at the Bloomer Church, it's time for us to schedule both a worship and an ad board meeting. So if you are on either of those committees, I will be sending out an email probably this afternoon. So please look for that so we can schedule a time to meet and prepare for fall and the remainder of the year. All right. Are there any other announcements that anyone else has this morning? I do have one public service announcement, and I'm a little hesitant to share this just simply because I haven't completely validated this story, but some of you may have heard that there was a Facebook post that had gone around about a couple that had been at North Park here in Bloomer, and a strange van pulled up and tried to lure one of the kids into the van. So folks, if you're a parent, please just be aware, be focused on your children, spend time teaching them some safety awareness and stuff like that, and for the rest of us, just do a job to care for us and our community, so we can prevent anything like that from happening. So just wanted to make you aware of that, and just please be safe as we go forward. At this time, I would invite you to just prepare your hearts and minds for worship this morning. Just release all of the stuff that you brought in with you this morning and just prepare to give that to God and just be fully present in this moment as we worship and glorify and praise Him. Hear these words. No matter what happened yesterday, now is the time to call upon God, to lay our lives before our Creator, and to proclaim God's wonderful deeds to one another. Now is the time to worship. Would you join me in this responsive call to worship this morning? Praise the Lord!
Yes, sing praises to God.
Praise the Lord!
We gather to give thanks for all God has done in our lives.
Praise the Lord!
We gather to worship our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer.
Amen. Would you pray with me this morning? God, we come before you with sighs too deep for words. Lord, we come with hearts overwhelmed by the world, our personal relationships, and by our inward struggles. God, we come this morning to praise your name and to be reassured by your unending grace. In this time and in this place, open our hearts to your presence. Open our ears to hear your word proclaimed. open our hands to serve you and the world. May our lives reflect Christ, who walks with us and gives us life. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. At this time, I would invite you to sing our opening song, "This Is My Father's World." Pretty powerful for one little seed, right? But is it us that moves the mountain, or is it God that moves the mountain?
God.
It's God, that's right. So that's our faith. This faith is, that can be just as tiny as this little mustard seed, allows God to do amazing things, to move mountains that show up in our lives. Okay? So I want you guys to remember that today, that if you guys ever go through some hard times or you're struggling with some things, just remember that you just need to believe just a little bit and say, God, will you just help me? I'm really struggling today and I just need you to help. And God can come in and he can clear all of that stuff out and help you to move on with your day, okay? All right, let me pray for you and then we'll continue with worship this morning. Dear God, we just thank you for these young disciples, and Lord, we just thank you for the faith that they have, and Lord, we just ask that you would continue to grow that in them, and that you would just continue to work through them in all that they do. Lord, help this church to continually come around and support them and nurture them and disciple them as they grow. Bless them as they go through each day this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our scripture reading today comes again from Matthew 13. We'll be looking at we'll be looking at verses 31 to 33 and then 44 to 52. So hear these words from Matthew. So he, Jesus, told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his field. Though it is the smallest of all seeds, yet when it grows, it is the largest of garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds come and perch on its branches. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour until it worked through all of the dough. And then continuing with verse 44, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all that he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into a blazing furnace, where there will be a weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. Yes, they replied. He said to them, therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom a new treasure as well as the old. This is the word of God for the people of God. So as we begin our message portion of our service this morning, I have a couple of reflection questions that I'd like you to consider, and you can feel free to answer them out loud if you choose. The first one is, where have you seen God at work in your life this week? Anybody got anything they want to share? Everything you catch is God's? Are you catching lots of cool stuff? Yeah. So all the animals you see, they all come from God. It's pretty cool that he puts all those things in our lives for us to see and play with. Holly, did you have something?
Yeah. I had a friend that had surgery for cancer on Tuesday and doing very well.
Good.
And I'm just saying.
Yeah, for the sunshine. And so again, many of us, you know, we're talking again some big things, but some small things. And again, just seeing the numerous infinite things that God puts in our lives all around us every day for us to witness and see. My second question for you, considering what you've seen God do this week, is how have you responded? What's been your response when you've seen God's hand at work?
Make some phone calls.
Okay, so it's urged you to take action and to serve others, to connect and be in relationship with each other. You know, I had the privilege of celebrating my anniversary this week with my beautiful wife who was up in Birchwood, and just how nice it was just to spend time with her and be able to go do some fun things and just continue to deepen the love that we have together. And so I'm just seeing God's hand in our relationship all along the way, even though there has been some times we have butted heads, just like any married couple does. But just so thankful and grateful for her and for the things God continues to do in our lives. So as we move in and begin to look at our scripture this morning, again, we have been spending the past few weeks in the 13th chapter of Matthew. We've been spending a lot of time looking at the different parables that Jesus has given to his hearers, his audience, but then also talk with in more detail to his disciples. And so we're continuing that today, and there's kind of a theme as we look through this. And so again, we start out with Jesus saying the kingdom of heaven is like this, and we see some examples. And the first few examples are really about the things that God does, about the cosmic scale, if you will, of how God is going to work and bring this kingdom to be. In the second one, the latter parables that we heard this morning, deal with our response. How should we respond to this idea, this gift, or this privilege of being part of God's kingdom? So think about that as we move forward this morning. And so again, he goes on and Jesus tells us this parable again about these tiny little seeds, these little mustard seeds that when planted become the mightiest of all of the trees, or for them, a very big tree probably in the Middle East. Okay, and so when we think of a mustard tree, it's not just some little shrub or some little tiny plant, but from this small tree, from this small seed, you get a tree. Okay? And so in many ways, you know, if we think about that today, I don't think I've ever personally seen a mustard seed, but we might equate that today for some of us, like, what does an oak tree look like? Again, a small, bigger nut, but how sturdy and strong does that tree become? If you want to go on a grand scale, think about a giant redwood tree, a sequoia or something, and think about the massive size that comes, again, just from a small seed. And so, again, Jesus begins his ministry, and what does the kingdom look like? It looks like a couple of fishermen, a couple of guys, walking around the lake doing ministry. Okay? It doesn't come in as some big army marching in and taking over big swaths of land and proclaiming everything for Jesus. No, it starts out, the kingdom starts out with Jesus and then goes on to 12 guys, and then it spreads on to a few more and to a few more and to a few more. Pretty soon it begins to influence the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire goes on to give us much of the values and things that we have taken in Western civilization. And to today, whereas the body of Christ is now worldwide. And so this small seed has spread throughout the entire globe. Okay? Now, for some of you that want to do a little bit of research and go back and dig through the Old Testament, a tree can also be synonymous with rule. Okay? And there's multiple places in our Old Testament where, again, there's talk of trees representing rulers. conquerors or kingdoms, if you will. And so if you want to go back, I encourage you to take a look at Judges 9, Ezekiel 17, and Daniel 4. And there you'll see some of this imagery again of these kingdoms or these kings that come in. Now the tree also provides shelter for these birds. And so again, it's saying to these people, again, in the Old Testament, to the Jewish people who would often find themselves oppressed or at, in struggle with some of their neighbors, God's kingdom come and say, here, look, I'll give you a place of safety. My kingdom may look like it's small, but my kingdom spans the entire universe. Come, find shelter on my branches. Come, build your nest here. Come, find the food and eat of the fruit of this tree. And so again, as we look at this parable, we need to continually remember that it is God who initiates all of these things. Okay? So often, we can try to find this balance between human response and God's work, and we can move too far to the side where we think we are the ones that have to do everything. But it's God's kingdom. Jesus is the one who came down and initiated the kingdom. It's Jesus who starts it all. And if we look back through the Old Testament scripture again, it's God who constantly moved. God who gave the people, the Israelites and the Jewish people, their power. Now again, just as I referred to with the young disciples, if we go just a few chapters further into Matthew, we find that, again, Jesus talks about this faith of a mustard seed again. But folks, that little bit of faith isn't so much about what we can do, but it's what God can do through us, okay? Because it's really God working through us that allows us to go and do the amazing things in our lives. And I've been thinking a lot about some of the things that just happened in our world, and it seems to me that there's a good number of people that are trying to do things on their own. And they're trying to do things without the help of God. And in many ways, you know, we see just some of the problems that it causes, because God, when we do the work of God, there shouldn't be divisiveness. There shouldn't be conflict necessarily, nor struggle with that. But as we do the work of God, we do it with His purposes in mind, not our own selfish aims and desires. And so, friends, I invite you to consider your faith and consider what the faith of a mustard seed may do in allowing God to work through you in your life. Again, whether you're with your family or in your marriage, in your place of work, how does that mustard seed manifest God's love and hope into other people's lives? Now Jesus goes on and he gives us yet another parable, and he talks about yeast, and he says, you know what, it takes just a little bit of yeast for this woman, this baker, to sort of infuse it into 60 pounds of flour and dough, okay? So now take a minute, if you will, and just think about the baking of a loaf of bread. And think about that, just the smell of that bread baking, or walking into a bakery or restaurant, and just that beautiful smell of warm, fresh bread. And think about that, think about the process. Okay, you're mixing these elements together, a little bit of flour, some water. And how much yeast does it take to infuse that, to get that bread to rise? Just a couple of teaspoons, right? Think about what a small amount of yeast it takes to create, and in this case, 60 pounds of dough. And so again, Jesus is saying, look, eventually my kingdom is going to infuse this world. And it's going to start out, maybe it's going to be small, but it's only going to take a little bit because it's that powerful. Okay? A couple of little seeds, a couple of little microorganisms like yeast, and pretty soon the whole thing is full and brimming. It's rising. And so, folks, again, think about the power of God, because it doesn't take something big for God to use it. The smallest of things, and God uses it. But because of God's power, everything is affected by it. So we move into a little bit of prophecy and revelation here. And so as we look at the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew as a writer, as an author, wanted to demonstrate how Jesus was a fulfillment of the law, okay? And scholars have noticed how the Gospel of Matthew has been divided into about five parts. And this chapter 13 that we look at is part of what's called the third division. And so we deal with some of the controversies that Jesus finds himself involved in, along with many of these parables. But Matthew puts this, the first part of this, in here again to show that Jesus is fulfilling the law all along the way. Okay, so he's looking back to the Jewish people and saying, look, our forefathers predicted this. They said that one would come that would do this, and Jesus is fulfilling all of these things. And if you look at the quotation on the bottom, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things hidden since the creation of the world. Okay, he's going back, he's quoting Psalm 78 here. And again, encouraging people to go back and look. It's sort of a history of the Jewish people and how they were to share and spread God to their families, to their communities, how they were to be a light to the world around them. And now Jesus is coming again and bridging the old with the new. He's not only part of that ancient tradition which he created, but he's also bringing out new things. Look, the things that you miss in all of your hurrying and all of your busyness and even in your disbelief, I'm making known to you right now. And folks, even today, how many people will miss Jesus? They missed him in his own day and age when he was performing the miracles before their very eyes. They chose not to see. They chose not to believe. And folks, again, as we look at the history of Christianity, we've gone kind of almost, we're moving in almost a full circle from this small rise of a few guys walking around the lake to an empire that proclaims Christianity as their main or one of their main religions, to a world that should know Jesus, and now we're seeing a shift in belief to we no longer need Jesus. We don't want the values of Jesus. And again, I'm not saying for all people, but we are moving into what's often called a post-Christian world. And we've gone from a focus on religion and on Christ to a focus on ourselves and what we want to believe and what we want to do. And it's causing problems all around. And so as Christians, just like the Jewish people in Psalm 78, we have a duty, a responsibility because of what God has given us, because we're members of this kingdom, we need to be sharing that, teaching our children, our grandchildren, sharing it with our neighbors, promoting values and things in our leaders and other people of influence. Now, the scripture this morning begins to shift, and we've looked again at the way God works. And again, this idea that God takes something just minute and small, and it goes to a colossal size from what it began as. And now we shift into that human response. Okay, so God has given us this kingdom. We get to participate and cooperate in this kingdom. What is our response? What should it be? And so we see two parables, one about a hidden treasure and the other one about a pearl. And so the first one says, you know, a guy is out looking around and he comes across a field that has this hidden treasure in it. And all of a sudden he gets really excited because he finds this treasure, he puts it back in place, and he goes and buys the field so he can have the treasure. The second one is almost the same. Again, a merchant is out going around looking for goods and looking for pearls, and he finds one of this great value, this priceless pearl, if you will. And he goes back and he sells everything so that he can buy it. Now, again, I suspect for many of us in our American culture, the idea of giving away all that we have or selling all that we have so we can go buy one thing is not something we like to normally think about. But I think there's some lessons here in those for us. And the first one is, are we searching? Are we out actively looking each and every day, each and every moment, for the things God is doing? Again, think back to that question I asked you at the beginning. Because again, we're not going to find necessarily all of the hidden treasures or those special pearls if we don't do our part in having a relationship with Jesus. Jesus always initiates. Jesus always pursues us. But a relationship is two-sided. And there are, I'm going to say again, there are treasures planted, hidden in our lives each and every day, and we have to go out and search for those and find those. And again, folks, many times we find those in not just the big things, but in the very small, mundane things of our lives. You guys have heard me quote Ann Voskamp many times in her book, A Thousand Gifts, and it's a book about gratitude. And she takes a journal and she just writes down the things that she's grateful for. Okay, which leads me to my next point. What is our priority? Where are our priorities? Again, are we looking for things? Is living in this kingdom our main focus? Are we living intentionally, doing the things that God calls us to do as disciples? And with priorities comes sacrifice, because when we choose one thing, it means we generally have to say no to another. And folks, again, we live in a world that loves and strives for busyness. Okay? We're constantly finding things to distract us or things to do so that we feel purposeful or meaningful. But where is God? Where is the kingdom in the midst of your priorities? Is it number one? Again, are you living in the ways of your life, allowing God to come through and be manifest in all the areas of your life? Are you willing to sacrifice your time, your energy, your resources to pursue that relationship, to spread the gospel, to share the good news with other people? Again, if we read the parable, sometimes it costs us a lot. Sometimes it costs us what we have in order to truly discover the amazing things that God has with us. But there's joy in it. Both the merchant and both the guy wandering around in the field find joy that they have discovered this. And folks, again, I will tell you that the deeper you go in your relationship with God, the more joy you will find. You will find nothing in this life that brings you more joy, more contentment, and more satisfaction than just leaning in to God. And folks, be grateful for that. When you see those beautiful things in your world, when you get to have a conversation with a friend, be thankful. When you see a smile on your child or grandchild's face, give thanks to God for that. Again, there's too many examples to list them all. But folks, we need a world that's filled with gratitude. Because when we're grateful for things, it moves our focus off of us and puts it on the right things. It puts it on the things that God is doing. It puts it on other people. Now, I know some of these verses are small. I just tried to put them all on there. The last parable Jesus talks about is the idea of a fisherman's net, and how, again, how this net goes down and it scoops up and catches all of these fish, and how the kingdom of God is like that, that eventually there will be a big catch. Okay? And this is what's to come at the end of the age, Jesus said. And so, folks, again, right now, but not yet. And I'm going to say, sometimes it's hard for us to live into that duality, to say, you know, the kingdom of God is right now, but it's not been fully consummated. We don't live in the perfection and in the supreme power of that kingdom yet, because it's not been fully manifested. But we do live in it right now, and God is working, God is building. We have the ability to cooperate along with that. But folks, again, there's hope here, because in the end, God triumphs. In the end, God's kingdom will reign supreme, There will be a time when there will be no more pain, there will be no more tears, there will be no more evil. God's kingdom will come, and when it's fully consummated, we'll sweep that away. And at once, I think our hearts will finally long and experience the justice that so many of us long for. And so again, for those of you that want to dig into the Old Testament a little bit, I encourage you to look up Habakkuk 1, Isaiah 19, and Ezekiel 26. And again, there's some more symbolism in that net example that he gives. And so friends, as we look to end our message time today, the last few verses talk about living as disciples. And folks, that's what we consider ourselves. We consider ourselves apprentices of Jesus. We consider that by coming to church and growing in our faith, growing in our relationship, that we're trained to do the work that God has called us to do. And so he tells his disciples, therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like an owner of the house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. And so, folks, again, because we have chosen a relationship with Christ, because we've chosen to become disciples, if God is truly working within us, our lives should change. We should see transformation. We should see changes in the words that we speak, in the actions that we do, in the way that we care for the people around us. We also have the job of interpreting things for other people. Again, showing them that life is different in the kingdom. And we move away from the old and into the new. And so folks, let us as a church continue to do that. Help us to reinterpret things from the past and discuss new opportunities for the future, knowing that God's kingdom will one day reign supreme in all things. So some action steps for you this morning. I encourage you to spend time this week searching for the blessings of the kingdom. Again, get a little journal, just keep or a little pad and keep it by your side and write down the special things, the things that you see God doing in your life, and see how that changes and transforms your life. Because folks, again, I've battled on and off for the last few weeks of, you know, trying to pay attention to the news and finding myself getting very negative and cynical, and I've had to reshift my focus and say, you know what, this isn't serving me. All it's doing is making me mad. And so I begin to look at what God is doing, and it's so much greater, so much more powerful. And in the end of the day, I just thank God for the things that he is doing, even when the major narrative is about all the things that are wrong. And again, I'm not trying to dismiss the things that are wrong, because there are things that are wrong. But again, God is at work. God is on the throne. And I don't have to live in fear or anger or any of those things. I just choose to live in as a disciple of Christ. So that's my second point. Disciple living. Be intentional about your lifestyle, about your words, about your actions. Are you living a life worthy of Christ? Again, I hope for all of you that there's not a change from you coming in this door to the time that you walk out, and that you live differently outside of this building. Two, share the gospel with others this week. I'm going to ask you to be intentional about talking with one or more people about God. Again, I'm not talking about taking your 10-pound Bible and swatting somebody on the head, saying repent or believe or anything like that. But again, just go to them and share the things that God is doing in your life. And if you've got your little list of things that you've witnessed, how ready are you then to say, you know what, I've seen God doing this amazing stuff, and I just wanted to reach out and talk to you today, and you've just been on my heart. And you never know where conversations like that may go. And folks, if some people turn you down and don't want to talk about it, then fine. Go find someone else and share it again. Plant those seeds each and every day. God bless. At this time, I would like us to lift up and share any joys or concerns that may be on your heart this morning. discussions with my mother, who is an ombudsman for the state of Wisconsin, and just it is a struggle because it feels like some of the facilities are just about to open and the staff member gets COVID and they have to go right back and shut down. And so it's difficult finding this balance between how we can allow family members and spouses to see loved ones in the midst of all that's going on. So yes, prayers indeed for that and for those people. Anything else this week?
Last week after the service, Debbie Walsh asked for prayers for Dwayne because he had a toe amputated.
Okay, so Debbie asked for prayers of healing for Dwayne for surgery.
Classmate and friend of ours, prayed Maureen, we call her Preeny Coon. She's got blood cancer and she's struggling.
So, prayers of healing for Maureen, who is dealing with cancer. Are there any others? May had come to me before service and she's going to be having some surgery on her wrist in August, so please lift her up in prayer as she prepares for that and pray that everything goes well for her. All right. Well, let us take a few moments and just lift these things up or anything else that may be on your hearts and minds this morning in some silence. Dear gracious and loving God, we just come to you and we thank you and praise you for this day. And Lord, we just pray that you will open our eyes and our ears to see all of the blessings that you have placed for us to discover this day. Lord, help us to devote our time and our energy and our resources to pursuing you, to sharing your love and hope with the world around us, for caring for those that are in need, to help create solutions where there are problems. Lord, right now we pray for all of the families that are struggling to find ways to visit their loved ones in the nursing homes. And Lord, we pray for the residents in all of those locations, as I suspect that the loneliness is great and high among many people. And folks, for many of us, a phone call is great, but it's still not the same as being able to see our loved ones, to be able to touch our loved ones. And so, Lord, be with them. Help them to navigate this difficult road. Help the nursing home facilities and care centers to make good and practical decisions. Help them to keep people as safe as they can. And Lord, we just pray for connection between those families and those loved ones. Lord, we pray for the Walsh family. We pray for Dwayne. Lord, just ask that he would continue to recover from the surgery that he's had. And Lord, we pray for Maureen and her cancer. Lord, we just ask that your healing hand be upon her. Lord, that you would just breathe life and energy and renewal into her. And Lord, we pray for a healing of this cancer. Lord, be with her as she journeys through this. Bring people, loved ones around her that will support her. Lord, give her the hope she needs to fight and to move forward. Lord, right now I also lift up these churches. And Lord, I just continue to ask that you would help us to move forward in obedience. Lord, that you would help us to live out our assignment, to go and to share your gospel, your grace, and your love with the world around us. Lord, help us to move through some of the conflicts that we have. Help us to be focused on discipling each other, to reaching new people. Lord, right now we pray also for all of those unspoken requests, all of those things that are deep and heavy on people's hearts this morning. Lord, lift those off of them. Let them know that you are present in this very moment, that you're already working. Give them your guidance. And Lord, we pray that your will be done in each and every one of those situations. Lord, we pray all of these things in your Son's name. Together and join in our closing song, Seek Ye First. Go forth knowing that you are part of God's family. Go forth proclaiming praises of God. Go forth in the assurance that Christ is always with us. Go forth to bring the kingdom of God wherever you are. God bless. Have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. If you need anything, please don't hesitate to reach out and get a hold of me. God bless.